Yo, what's up? What are you doing? Brooklyn Biologist back with another episode of the Alimentary Canal Layers.
It was a cafe on the west side, midtown. Said they had the best Kappa cappuccino around, so I stepped in and ordered a cup. Someone grabbed me by my throat and said, shut up.
Oh my God, curse was on the way. I had to cut it. That's MC Light with Cappuccino. If you don't know about that song, I don't know what to tell you. But I'm back. Brooklyn Biologist, another episode, Alimentary Canal Layers. Let's get it going. Technology's working for us. Good. You're doing the digestive system with the teacher. You're looking through the textbook. You're looking at the PowerPoint, whatever you're doing. And eventually you're going to do a tour of the digestive system. And you're going to start at the top and eventually work your way through the whole entire system, yada, 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 out through the exit chute. But before you do that, your professor, me, says, you know what? Let's take a look at the histology of a typical section of the alimentary canal. Let's look at a typical section. Let's do a transverse cut, if you will, and see what the histology of the alimentary canal is in a typical section. So you come to a figure like this and, oh my God, you gotta be kidding me with this, right? Seems like these graphics are just getting more and more clumped up and crowded as the days go on. So you gotta be kidding me, but have no fear. We're going to tackle this thing bit by bit so that it's going to be in digestible parts. Oh, you like that pun? So do I. Let's go. Let's break it down. Let's start from the deepest layer and work our way out, the mucosa. All right. So we're going to talk about the epithelium, the lamina propria, and the muscularis mucosae layer. And so the mucosa itself has three features to talk about. Now, I'm going to give you a chance to do some critical thinking here. Knowing what the digestive system is all about, that it involved in a lot of secretion and absorption and self-protection, what type of epithelial lining would you anticipate would make up the majority of the alimentary canal or the GI tract? Pause the video right there. Put an answer in your head. And we're back. So I hope you came up with something interesting to talk about there. Give you guys opportunities to think ahead, all right? Let's put some information on the slides. There's gonna be a lot of information to talk about right away with the deepest layer, the mucosa layer. So right away, what can we say? The epithelium is mostly, for the most part, is gonna be simple columnar epithelial cells. Did you say that in your answer? I hope so. Why? Because they're gonna have a lot of secreting opportunities throughout the length of the tract. There are some exceptions. Here are our exceptions. The mouth, the esophagus, and the anus. Stratified squamous epithelial lining. Now I'm gonna let you take a moment to answer that question. Why would it be a good idea to have this type of epithelial tissue at these locations? Pause the video. I'll be right here when you get back. And we're back. Well, I hope you mentioned something about, there's still a lot of friction and abrasion happening here because food is either coming in or things are leaving, right? And so you don't necessarily need a secretion happening here. What you need more is a protective layer. You need like a shield that can get sloughed off pretty easily and replaced very quickly. All right, the mucosa serves to protect our digestive organs from enzymes. We're going to hear that a little bit when we talk about the stomach and whatnot. Protect organs from digesting themselves with their own secretions. Easing the food passage along the way, the mucosa is, we try to have a low friction lining. And as we said before, a lot of secretion going on. But what's up with these other layers? A lamina propria? What's that all about? Let's take a look. The lamina propria is made up of areolar connective tissue. Sort of looks that way if you look at the graphic. Yeah? It's highly vascularized. This is where nutrients are taken up by the network or the bed of capillaries that are just superficial to the epithelial layer. Aha, so uptake. This is where you're also going to find some of those mucosal associated lymphoid tissues, your malt for your lymphatic system. All right, we're off to a good start. That's one layer down. We got three more to go. Let's keep going. The submucosa. Interesting. Let's take a look at it in this cartoon right here real quick. What do you see here? What do you see here and here? Here's some more of those structures. Okay, so I think we get an idea. What's the consistency of this cartoon? What type of tissue does it look like it might be composed of? Pause the video. Come right back. And you're back. All right, the submucosa. Here we go. More areolar connective tissue, that loose connective tissue with a lot of open spaces. This is a layer that is also highly vascularized. Blood, lymphatic vessels, nerve endings, lymphoid follicles. Oh, and here we go, submucosal nerve plexus. Ah, so this is our vascular layer. The submucosa also contains elastic fibers, and this would allow an organ such as the stomach to regain its shape to recoil after expanding to accommodate food contents. Okay, submucosa, excellent. So we're gonna go a little bit more superficial now. And now we're at the third layer, the muscularis externa. I should have backed up and mentioned that this thin muscular layer that surrounds the lamina propria and the endothelium, this has just a little bit of motion to assist in secretions and absorption to this layer. So we got to knock out that muscularis mucosae layer. So we did a little retroactive discussion right there about that part of the layer. So now we're going to move on to the thicker, more obvious, attention-grabbing muscular layer, and that's the muscularis externa. Okay, we have a circular layer and a longitudinal layer. You can see that. Look at the direction that these muscle cells are aligned in and the direction these are coming out at you. So I'm going to give you another opportunity to answer some questions and think to yourself in the video. Why should we have a muscularis layer in the lining of our GI tract or our alimentary canal? What function is it serving, huh? Also, what type of muscle tissue is it? Smooth, cardiac, or skeletal? Why would it be a good idea to have two? Give you a second chance at that. Pause the video. You're not crazy for speaking to yourself for a moment or two. And we're back. Okay. So the muscularis layer. Let's put a little bit of text on the screen and let's discuss. Why is it a good idea to have at least two layers? I say at least two because the stomach will present us an exception later on. Because we move food along in an involuntary fashion thanks to this smooth muscle layers through two actions, segmentation and peristalsis. And we'll get into those more in a little bit, but they are the movements involuntarily caused by contractions of smooth muscles to move food along through your digestive system. All right, and it's a good idea to have an inner circular layer so it squeezes it almost like a sphincter style, right? Dilation and contraction. And a longitudinal layer to have wave-like movement in a linear fashion, right? So a circular layer for squeezing and relaxing and a longitudinal layer for wave-like movement. They're both wave-like contraction, but you get the idea, okay? In fact, that circular layer at key points in your alimentary canal thickens in some areas and forms sphincters. You have a bunch of sphincters around your body controlling the entry and exit of food contents, chyme, bolus, etc., into and out of organs. Okay, let's keep going. Three layers down, one layer to go. If we're already here at the muscularis external layer, we're pretty much at the external covering now. And so think back to your serous membranes. Think back to those key words, visceral versus parietal, because now we're at the membrane covering layer, right? We're at that fourth layer. And it's our serosa, or the serous membranes, made up of connective tissue with a single layer of squamous cells called a mesothelium on top. But let's populate this slide a little bit with some information. The serosa, this is the visceral peritoneum. Remember, visceral means actually in touch with the organs, not to be confused with the parietal, which also exists, but we're just talking about the layers of the actual alimentary canal organs themselves, not their cavity lining, right? Areolar connective tissue with that single layer of squamous epithelium around it called a mesothelium. Whew, so those are the four layers, my friends. We just worked our way from deep to superficial. Four stops along the way, right? Watch it and review it. And at this point in the lecture, we're ready to jump back into our tour of the digestive system and begin with the oral cavity. So questions, comments, observations, critiques, leave them below. Click this, click that, like, subscribe, do whatever you gotta do, or don't. Point is, you watched the video, you enjoyed yourself, and maybe you learned a little something. So I'm done with this topic, and like my Aunt Cindy used to say, if I'm done, you're done. Boom.